everyone today, just as a little future tease, on March 30th, March 20th, this spring, Mr. Jeff Pertle is bringing Arturo Sandoval to school at Merritt Theater. Well, you'll hear more about that as it comes up. Now, I've had the time of my life today. When I was 15 years old, my parents took me to a national stage band camp, and this guy was my saxophone instructor. How many years has it been? He hasn't aged a bit. I'm a lot older, but I've had so much fun today, and it's been an honor to be around this guy, Jamie Abersol.
Thank you very much, Jeff. How many of you are jazzers? Okay, so that means the rest of you are just musicians, as I might be. All right. Okay, I'm going to be here until probably 5:30. If you have to get up and walk out because you've got something else going on, that's fine. But I want to start by saying I haven't done anything like this for a little while. Okay, I'm used to doing jazz. People are interested in jazz from the beginning, knowing nothing, to the ones who already play, and you wonder maybe why they're at my one-hour clinic or whatever. But today I'm going to stress that everything I say, absolutely positively, everything I say relates to making music. And not just reading notes on the page. I'm not a very good sight reader because I need to spend time doing it. Okay, but I've got a great memory, and I've memorized hundreds of songs, popular songs, jazz songs, and so forth, and I've memorized the scales and chords, arpeggios that are needed for those tunes, and I can play some of them in different keys, okay? So the idea of sitting down like I was doing here, spiking the piano, which is in treble clef, you know, or concert key, and I'm transposing over here and playing, is something I've kind of worked on. I like to get to the stage where I can play one tune, like Tenderly or Body and Soul, or I Can't Get Started, or What's New. But the problem is, at least I haven't figured out how to finger F, which takes two hands, and F sharp. All the other notes I can get. Some of them sound a little funny. But everything I'm going to mention to you pertains to making yourself a better musician and having fun playing music. Okay? Now, having said that, anybody can learn how to read the notes on the page. You take a novice, you give them 10 minutes, and you give them the staff, either the treble or the bass clef. You get your lines in your spaces, and you kind of think about it and so forth, and you exercise, practice a little bit, and then you spend the rest of your life sight reading to get faster at it, don't you? Yeah, that's what we do. And the more time you spend on it, the better sight reading you will be. And I've seen some jazz musicians who can, it's just incredible. I can't believe how fast they can read and see stuff and interpret and have it come out with their instrument, whatever their instrument is. And like I told you, I'm not a very good sight reader. But the reason I'm not is I spent the majority of my life, I was 75, and I started playing music when I was 5, and got fired 5 years later from the piano. She gave me my $2 back, said, Jamie, go on home, you'll never be a musician. You don't want to practice. And I was tired of practicing an hour a day on the piano. Along the way, had she had me take some of those scales that I was doing, two hands, four octaves, and so forth, and improvise a little bit on it, I'd still be playing the piano. I would not have had to wander over to the banjo, which I took lessons on, saxophone, clarinet. Then when I went to school, they didn't offer, at Indiana University, they didn't offer saxophone, so they put me on a woodwind degree, oboe, bassoon, flute, clarinet. And none of that is what I wanted to do. I started listening to music. My mom and dad played music, but they didn't play jazz. They played Sammy Kay and Guy Lombardo, what they call the sweet band, sweet music, standards, playing standard tunes from the Great American Songbook. So I heard them every day, and we didn't eat lunch or supper. We called it supper. Anybody still use supper? Good. Well, I'm in the South. Okay. We never ate lunch or supper. And my dad put a stack of 78s on the record player. And I was a real slow eater. So I got to hear all the songs. Okay? Those songs came back to me later when I started playing jobs with our little band in high school. We had a group called the Nighthawks. And we played at a lot of the animal clubs in the town that I lived in, which was New Albany, Indiana, like the Moose and the Elks and the Lions Club. And we played these little arrangements. And it was a big deal if I could make it through the arrangement without making a mistake. And we're not talking about improvising. We're just talking about reading the notes. But I never really practiced my parts. But it was a challenge each time we played one of these tunes to make it through it without making one mistake on the saxophone or the clarinet. So I'm here today to talk to you about making music. If you learn to read music and become a good reader and so forth, that's important, okay? But if you don't learn to improvise, that's sad, because everybody can improvise. Everybody can improvise. Everybody can improvise. I know they can. I've been doing this for 50 years. And I call people out of the audience, and I ask them to come up and sing, and I play the piano, and they can play, they can sing. Could they take their trumpet and do that, or their guitar, or their trombone, or their sax? Nope. Not until you get this thing under control. I'll just use this as an example, all right? But I found out a long time ago that everybody can sing, the mind knows where it's at, and it's the ears can hear the piano or the accompaniment, and it's not real fast and complex. You sing melodies. And the first time I did this with someone was a young boy, high school student. I was up in New Hampshire. We practiced for about an hour on scales and chords and things. Now, I probably had to play it all again. I don't even remember. But it seemed like the right thing to do to summarize what I had talked about was, I said, would you mind coming up and playing? So it was like a 16-year-old alto player. He comes up and I say, okay, you stand right here and just follow me. And I started off. Him in the key of C. And he starts to play, but he's not matching any of my notes at all. And I was a little confused because it's the first time I've ever asked anybody to do this, okay? So he plays, you know, maybe 20 seconds, and I change key, hoping to pick up some right notes. And he goes further out in space and gets more wrong notes. And I'm thinking, wow, this is not working at all. So we play maybe a minute and a half, and we stop. The kids didn't applaud. I'm sure that his friends were thinking, why is Jamie embarrassing Joe? Because it really didn't sound good at all. So we stopped, and I'm sitting here thinking, well, that's not what I thought was going to come out at all. So I said to him, I said, would you mind singing? And thank goodness, he said, no. I said, okay, lay your alto on the chair. He lays it on the chair. We start again, and he takes a microphone, which was down at the end of the piano. That's probably what made me think of it. I saw that mic. And I said, do you mind singing? He said, no. I said, put your alto on the chair and grab the mic. Then we start playing again, and he does something like this. And I didn't make the recording any simpler. But this is him. And I'd love to know who he was. Because he really changed my life. Alright? Because he made me look at each person and see, are there only certain people that can improvise and they can sing like this guy sang? I found out, no. As a matter of fact, up at Asheville on Monday when I did my first workshop for an hour, I asked, yeah, it was Monday night. There was about 25 people there, and I asked for a volunteer. A guy raised his hand and plays harmonica, okay? He came up and sang one of the best solos I've ever heard in my life with my random. It was marvelous, and as a matter of fact, I've got it on video, and I need to go back and listen to it because I thought it was stupendous. And he sang without any fear at all, but his ear just followed my chord progressions, and I moved through different keys. That is improvisation. That's the height of improvisation. He was soloing, he had no idea what key I'm in, whether it's major or minor, he didn't know where I was going, but yet we took this journey together and made music that you can't make oftentimes on your instrument because you don't have it under control. And when sometimes when you try to play and what you hear in your mind, what you want to come out, doesn't come out, then your ego pops up and says, I told you couldn't do it. Go watch a video. Go back and start reading music, you know, go practice your piece. You got this coming up, you got that coming up. Give up on this idea of improvising because you can't do it. I'm here to tell you that's incorrect. You can do it, all right? So this boy starts singing. And when he sang a note like that, my brain said, man, that's a sharp five, sharp four on a down the seven chord. If he were playing saxophone and I was giving him lessons once a week, we wouldn't get to that note in his solo until he practiced and played with me for 2 or 3 years. But here he is, in the first 15 seconds, singing a note that on your instrument takes a long time to learn how to naturally fall into. Ooh, be sitting there kind of in a daze. I'm confused. And what I'd normally say if you were playing a saxophone and did that, I would say something like, you've got a great sound on the saxophone. gee, and you've got your harm down. I can tell you've listened to Jazz Bears. Yep. And you've been working on your scales and your chords and you're bringing your ideas right out of your mind. But I couldn't say any of that because he was singing. So I said, you've really got a lot of music in you. You are quite talented. And all the time I'm thinking saxophone, he doesn't have it yet. Okay? And I said, you know what you need to do? He said, what? Oops. I said, you, and I pointed to a saxophone. I said, you need to learn how to play the saxophone, or nobody's going to know that you have all this music in you. And just as I tell you that right now, I get chills in my head. That, to me, tells me that what I'm telling you is the truth, at least for me and for that boy. But it's actually the truth for everybody, because I've done it so many times. I've had so many people come up and say, and they don't know what I'm going to do, and this, that, and the other. But it comes out marvelous. And then I think by the time they leave the lecture, they realize that, well, Jamie actually feels me, I can do this. And I do know you can do it. But you're not going to be able to do it on this or your instrument until you get your scales and your chords and so forth under control. Because that's a monster. This thing here is a monster. Why we don't all sing, I don't understand. We'd be so much happier if we were singers. Believe me, when it comes to improvisation. All right? So now I'm going to just talk about some things and lead up to how in the world can you get that thing to play what you hear in your head. And a good place to start is, start out simply. And start on different notes. Great places to start because it gives you some confidence and you're actually playing maybe with your eyes shut, you know, you're playing from memory, simple little things. And you might say, as a matter of fact, I said for years, oh, this don't have people start like that because that's got nothing to do with jazz. What we're talking about is making your mind, the notes that you're hearing in your mind, and instantly convey them on your saxophone or your whatever instrument you play. So don't pick something hard and you can't play it and then say, oh, I knew I couldn't do this, you know. That's stupid. You don't need to do that. Because everybody has this in. It just takes a little time to get started. And you'll be surprised how quickly you can overcome obstacles and become better and better at it. And as you do that, your fear of doing this just sort of wanders out the window. But if you're not strong-willed, your ego will pop up. It's a battle. It'll pop up and say, go get a pizza. Watch a video. Call your friend. Go play basketball. Take a walk. Don't practice. Because it knows if you get your instrument under control, you can spend too much time with it. Plus, you might be happy. You know? You might be happy with what you do. And you got to be careful, because that ego is going to stick around and it's going to batter you down as much as possible. You know? Okay, so I would start off with simple little things like nursery rhymes, play those. All right? And then you move over to where you're maybe playing something like this. Uh-oh, that was my cork. You know why the cork is in the bell? Where'd it go? There it is. Here, throw it back in there. It helps the low notes to come out. How many of you are saxophone players? Yeah, if you look on the internet, cork in the bell of saxophone, you'll be surprised how much talk there is about it. And it does make the lower notes come out easily. Easier. There's something about my horn that did. Certain instruments are kind of that way. Okay, this is my good old Volume 1 play along. It came out in 1967, so it's about 47 years old. Start off with an LP. Anybody not seen an LP? Oops. LPs, yeah. They were around for a long time. Do you know at one point here, probably 6 or 7 or 8 years ago, I rented a dumpster. I think it was 30 feet long, 8 foot wide, 5 foot tall, and we filled it with LPs, play-along LPs, and said goodbye to them as they went out the driveway. Nobody was buying LPs. We did save some. Okay, so this is good old Volume 1, and it sounds like this. This whole idea, let me put that on pause for a second. This whole idea of play-along records, play-along CDs, came about because I wanted somebody to play with. I wanted to play with the piano, bass, and drums. In high school, and I didn't have one. My mom and dad bought a Hammond organ when I was 12 years old, okay? And I learned how to walk the bass lines on the lower manual and play some chords on the right, and and a Seth Thomas metronome was going like that. My dad had bought a Duquesne reel-to-reel tape recorder, so I'd set it up, put the microphone up on the keyboard here, on the top of the organ, and I made my own play-along tapes. I did the blues and B-flat, I think, or maybe F, and I did a couple other tunes. I even took that tape recorder and the tape with me to college. And I'd take it out of my locker, take it up the third floor, practice with it. I wanted to play with somebody else, you know? So this play-along idea came along about 4 or 5, 6 years after I was out of college. And the reason it came along was I was at a camp in the summertime up in Storrs, Connecticut, and at the end of the week, I was given a saxophone lesson, sitting at the piano, and two boys were sitting there with their tenor and alto, and one of them, when we got through playing, I was accompanying them, he said, would you make me a reel-to-reel tape with the blues and B-flat, and what was the other one? There'll Never Be Another You. And I said, yeah, I can do that. But I never did do that. Instead, I put out volume one, LP and book, okay? And then a couple years later, put out volume two. And now we've got like 133. And for a lot of people around the world that have bought my play-along records on either cassette, LP, or CD, and have this book, this and the play-alongs are their teachers. And that's how they play music, okay? Now that's it. They don't have a band to play with. They don't have a combo to play with. They don't have any college to go to. No combo classes, no arranging class, no jazz class, no big band. They're playing the Jamie Russo play-along records, all right? And my count-off, which you'll hear in a second, has become pretty universal. I remember walking across the Thames River in London about 6 or 7 years ago with a friend of mine, 11 o'clock at night, we're going back to the train station, crossing the bridge, I hear somebody out there in the middle playing tenor. And I say to Shelley, I say, Martin's using my play-alongs. I said, no, that's not it, because that's not my play-along. So we get up there and he ends the tune, nobody else in sight, and we applaud. And I just casually said, do you have any Abe or so? Oh yeah. And he goes to his iPod or whatever he had, and he brings up Joy Spring by Clifford Brown in volume 16. He plays a melody, he improvises several choruses, plays the melody again, and then realizes there's one more chorus, like the track is not going to stop. So he improvises another chorus and he stops. As soon as he finishes, we applaud, I go, one, two, a one, two. I get to about three, and he says, you're Jamie Ebersole. Just by the voice. It's cute. Okay, so let me play a little bit with the blues here. This is, I'm on piano, Rufus Reed is on bass, and a fellow that I've been playing with for nearly 50 years on drums, Jonathan Higgins, who at the age of 13, his dad took him to hear the great Duke Ellington Orchestra at the Adelaide Country Club in Lexington, Kentucky. I was there that night, okay? Me and my friend were sitting right in front of the sax section. But we must not stay for the second section because that's when my friend Jonathan was asked to play drums. And Duke was so impressed with this boy's drumming at age 13 that he asked him to join the band. He played 4 songs with Duke Ellington. And Johnson's dad had the good sense to say no. Can't imagine a 13-year-old boy out with all those guys. Okay, so he's the drummer, I'm the piano player on this, and Rufus Reed's the bass player. This is what we call the chord progression, or the changes. It's not only the chord progression, it's the chord slash scale progression. So when we start to play, if we play a tune that we don't know, we'd like to see what the harmony is going to be, and this is it. It's played 11 times on this particular, it's track 7, it's in a B-flat concert. If you play trumpet or tenor or soprano or clarinet or alto or baritone or bass clef, you turn to another page in volume 1 and it's all written out for you. But now when I started out, there was none of this. Nothing, no paper. All you had was your 2 years and you had your records. And you listened and you listened and you listened and you listened and you hoped that you got to the point where you could actually play some of the stuff you were hearing on those records. I was looking for a particular sheet, but I don't see it right now. This cart doesn't want to stay in there. All right, let's call the blues. And here's what I'd like you to do. The blues, every tune we play has forms. In other words, we're not just going wild. When that major occurs, I'm trying to play an idea off of that scale. When we move to this scale, one note changes, the D goes down to D flat. And I try to adhere to that. Okay, then when we go back to here, the D flat goes back to D. So we're constantly changing keys you can think of. You can think of it that way. The blues scale at the bottom will work anywhere in the progression. And many people learn the blues scale and they stop there. They never learn to make dominant seventh ideas. And they can't connect like that. They take this scale, it's like wearing tennis shoes everywhere. You wear tennis shoes to church, you wear it to a wedding, you wear it to a funeral home, you wear it to bed. You know, that's the blues scale. And the minor pentatonic is next to it, all right? And the minor pentatonic is missing the E natural. So this scale almost sounds like this scale. And both of these have notes that are different than what the piano and the bass are playing. But our ears over the last 100 years have learned to make this sound okay, and we like it. So here we go. 1, 2, 1, 2, 3, 4. Clap your hands at the beginning of the next chorus. 2, 1, 2, 3. Okay, now I see some of you clapping, but you clap on with every bar. You're going clap. Clap, 2, 3, 4. What I want you to do is clap here. And when we come back around, clap there again, okay? So that's the beginning of each chorus. A chorus is like a chapter. And sometimes when people solo, they might solo 15 or 20 choruses on the blues if they have if they feel like they have a lot to offer, okay? 1, 2, 1, 2, 3. Between the scales and the rhythm and the sounds that they're playing, and superimposing the blues scale or the minor pentatonic scale over the top. How about a little chromaticism? Especially in this key, because that's a pretty easy key here. Now if you were to take it up a half step and play the blues, or down a half step, I have to really put my thinking cap on, all right? Because it would be easy to play the wrong notes. I can hear the phrases, but all of a sudden I'm pushing different buttons, you know? So, take a look at this. Now this is, incidentally, before I do this, let me put this over here as a reminder. This rock is 450 million years old. Sometimes I call it the Rock of Ages, okay? This rock is really old, and jazz is really young. Jazz is only about 110 years old, and it's just getting started. And every solo I play and every solo you play is adding to the evolution of this music. Little by little, it's getting older and older. And jazz education's only been around about 50 years, started in the 50s. When I grew up, I was born in 1939, I'm 75 now. But when I grew up, I listened to records, which I now have about 15,000, okay? I've done a whole lot of listening, but I was probably 20 or 25 or 30 years old before I started analyzing what it was I was listening to, okay? At that point, I was starting to teach others. So I had to stop and think, what is it I want them to do to bring out their music, you know? I don't want them to sound like me, they're not going to anyway. I have had students say, for instance, I'll say to them, have you listened to Art Farmer and Kenny Dorham and Clifford Brown, trumpet player? No, How come? Oh, I don't want to sound like them. Now that's your ego talking. That's talking big time. Your ego is telling you, don't listen to those records because you sound like them. And you won't be original. And if you're not original, it's not jazz. Okay? So go a different route. Play polka music. I'm just kidding. You have to listen to others. All the answers to your questions are on the records. Okay? You can buy one good Charlie Parker record, and they're all good by Charlie Parker. And everything about theory and harmony is on that record. He's utilizing the entire chromatic scale, not but note by note, you can analyze it. When a major chord is sounded, he can play any of the notes of chromatic scale. He uses them as a appoggiaturas, upper neighbors, lower neighbors, this side and the other, chromaticism, blah, 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 blah. Okay? When minor shows up, he can do the same thing. When dominant and seventh scale show up, he can do the same thing. And he can throw the blues scale across the top of it. So the jazz musicians in the last 50 years have taken traditional European harmony and kind of wrung it out. What does it have to offer? It's got the chromatic scale. What are we going to do with it? It's divided into qualities. Major scales and chords, minor scales and chords, and incidentally there's about four different minors. Okay, but the one that's prominent and really dominant is the Dorian minor scale. Dominant seven scales and chords with alterations, half too many scales and chords. Blues scale. The blues scale is like a tenor shoot. It can fit into any of the other qualities. So, Western music does this. Let's say you start your solo. Somebody starts a solo. They play one note. Here's what they can do. They can hold the note. They can repeat it. Or they can rest. And then they can come back and hit it again, repeat it, hold it, whatever. If you've got electronic instruments, you can hold it until the electricity goes up. Alright? Sooner or later, you're going to play another note, above or below. How are you going to get to that note? All right? You're going to get there by playing bits and pieces of scales, bits and pieces of chords, which come out of the scale. The chords are 1, 3, 5, 7, 9 of the scale. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8. 8 and 1 are the same. And incidentally, if you're not used to thinking numbers, you need to start thinking numbers. If you don't think numbers, then you've got to be right. A flat, B flat, C. D flat, E flat, F, G, A flat, and then move to another key, then you gotta write F sharp, G sharp, A sharp. This way, it makes it easy. All right? Now, what else can you do? Well, you can make some leaps, or a leap, and you can go chromatic. This is it. And if you analyze Western music, you're gonna find that these two right here, scales and chords, bits and pieces of scales and chords are the biggies. And they're coupled with held notes, rest, repeat, and jazzers like to do sequence. Play a phrase over the C chord. The next one over here is A flat. They play that same thing, but they move it to the key of A flat. That's called sequencing. And that's how we practice, incidentally. You play something in the key of C, then you play it in D flat, then you play it in D, then you play it in E flat. You go up chromatically, all right? Or maybe you practice down in half steps. You're gonna play Mary Had a Little Lamb starting on C, then you try it on B, then you try it on B flat, and work your way through all 12 keys. All right? But these are the big two right here, coupled with leaps and chromaticism. If your solo had nothing but chromaticism, you'd put people to sleep, because too quickly they would find out that this sound that you're doing is going to continue, and they tend to not pay attention. So we need variety. If you just went up and down scales, they would think that what you're playing is an exercise. Even if you're playing jazz articulation and stuff, sooner or later they would be thinking this whole thing is just kind of going like this. There's no leaps in it. And if you just went up and down arpeggios, I'm sure it would sound like an exercise, all right? Very quickly. Even to the novice, they can't say, oh, he sounds like he's playing just chords. But there's that sameness to it. So what we do is we break it up with rest, we hold notes, we repeat, we use sequences, we use scales, bits and pieces of scales, chords, and leaps and chromaticism, and that's how we come out with our solos. All right? Boo ba doo 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 dee dot dot. That's all scale. Boo doo 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 dee doo dee da oo boo da. Up the chord, down the scale. Bee ba oo boo da. Doo doo dee doo dee doo da. That's leaps, but I'm also emphasizing like 3, 5, flat 7, but down at 7. Boo dee doo dee doo dee da. That's leaps going up in fourths, going up in whole steps. Doo dee doo dee doo dee doo dee doo dee doo dee ah. I'm singing perfect fourth interval, like C or C. Let me see if I can find it. Anybody have perfect pitch? Somebody's pointing to somebody. Oh, down there, good, okay. Excuse me if I'm out of tune. Let me see if I can find a C. Hang on. La, is that a C? La, 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 la. He raised the thumbs up. Now here's how I got that. I don't have perfect pitch, but I'll divert from that for just a second. In college, we had a jazz arranging class. I don't even know if we got credit for it, but there was two of us in the class. And a fellow from Columbus, he lives in Columbus, Georgia now, Roger Pemberton. Any of you know Roger Pemberton? Okay, good. He was my sax teacher. They didn't have a sax teacher, but he came for his graduate degree, and instead of me studying with the clarinet teacher, which I did the first year, they let me study with Roger. Anyhow, Roger was really something else, all right? But I had discovered this card that was on a Horace Silver record. Probably from a tune. And I love that sound, so that's like a D-flat 7 with a sharp 9. Roger walks into the room, it's a practice room, and I ask him, I say, hey Roger, what's this? And I hit it. Oh, that's a C sharp 7, sharp 9. And I looked down at the keyboard, I knew that's what I played, but I couldn't believe that he could just say it. So I said, well, how do you know that? He said, well, it just sounds like it. I said, it sounds like it. Wow. So I moved it up to E. And I said, what if I played that? He said, oh, I'd say E7 sharp 9. And I got up from the piano, he's laying his briefcase down on the little table in the room. I said, Roger, how can you do that? That's what I want. I want to know what people are doing. When I play all these records, I've been playing for years, you know, and I'm already, 19 years old or something, and I don't know what's going on. He says, well, I've transcribed a lot of big band records. Right then, my brain goes, boom. Now, my brain says, there were no CDs and there were no cassette recorders. There were just LPs. So you mean Roger is dropping a needle and hearing a bar or two, putting the needle over in the rest, taking his pencil, which is big score paper with 5 saxes, 4 trombones, 4 trumpets, and a rhythm section. And he's taking his pencil and writing what he hears, and then he drops the needle again and waits for that spot to come up, and then he pulls the needle over. Yes, that's what he did. Because there were no big band arrangements published at that time. So if you wanted to play something with your big band, somebody had to write all the parts on it. So Roger developed great ears. And I can still see me walking out of the music building, and it seemed like I did this. I got out to the street, and I went like that, and stopped the first car, and I said, do you know what Roger can do? I told everybody at school music, I said, do you know what Roger can do? Roger can hear a sound, and he can tell you what it is, and he's right. And of course, that's what I wanted to do. So Buddy Baker, the trombone player, I was telling him probably the next day about this, and he said, well, go across the street, get your pitch fight. I said, what is this? How's that going to do it? He said, well, get your C to C chromatic and learn your intervals. For instance, play C and just see if you can sing an A and check it. Hit C, see if you can sing a minor triad and check it. Carry it with you all the time. Well, I went right across the street and bought it, and it looked just like this. And I was about a half a block away, and I was telling this story the other day. There was a vacant lot over here. I was walking back to my apartment, and I blew, and I checked off to make sure the place it does. So I said, well, I'm going to sing up a chromatic scale, come back down, end on C, and wipe this off, and take it back, and get $5, because I can buy a record for that. Well, I sang up, and I didn't end on C. Instead, here's what I did. I looked over my shoulder to see if anybody had seen me make this terrible mistake. I really did. And I said, well, let me see if I can sing the C major scale. So I went up the C major scale, came back down, didn't end on C, and this time I didn't turn my head around. I'm bewildered. I can't believe that I can't sing a C major scale, or any scale, and end on the note I started with. So I think I shook it, thinking maybe it was broken. It wasn't broken. So then I said, well, let's see if I can sing from, by that time I'm looking at it, it says C, C sharp, D. Let me see if I can go from C to D. So I go, la, la. Wow, that's good, okay. Let's go C to C sharp. La, la. Wow, sang D again. La, la. And I'm really bewildered. I can't believe I can't sing a half step. Now, I've never sung in my life except in church, and we always sing the melody. I didn't even sing the harmony parts, okay? It took me a week before I could get to where I could sing a chromatic scale one octave. 1 week. And boy, I didn't give up, because I couldn't believe I couldn't do this. And I wasn't looking over my shoulder either. I put it in my car, and every time I'm out driving, I put it up in the above the sun visor. And I pulled that sun visor down, and this thing would literally come down, smack me on the head, go down on the bottom of my 53 Ford, and I reached down there and get it, and that was the signal to get it out and start ear training with the radio. No cassettes, no CDs, you know, and not much jazz on the radio then either, but I started guessing keys that those bands and stuff were playing in and so forth, and I just stuck with it. And I got to the point where I could do this. But as a matter of fact, standing out there on the sidewalk that day, bewildered, that came into my head. Just like this. And it's been there ever since. If you ask me questions about saxophone, I don't see that. I see fingerings. I play bass. If you ask me about the bass, I see the bass, and I see fingerings and positions. Any other question you ask me, anything I'm talking about, that pops up. Now, it doesn't consciously pop up, but it's there, and I'm always, because you can see everything. So if you haven't memorized the keyboard and stuck it up in your forehead for use, I strongly, strongly, strongly suggest that you do it. This keyboard and the chromatic scale is your musical alphabet, and you need it. You need it, you need it, you need it, in order to figure out what those notes you're singing in your head are. So, I practice with this. I'll give you a demonstration. Where's he? And you come in and check yourself every now and then. La di da do di do ba do 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 ba 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 blue scale bo ba do da do be boy ba do do de 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 ba do ba do do da be bo ba do ba do de de a po do bo do 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 da ba do do be ba do 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 de o po do 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 da bo do de do do de ba o ba do de bo de bo de de bo la. You check it. I'm a little flat. I need to pump myself up. Dee doo doo dee da doo doo da. Dee doo doo da boo dee doo da. Be doo doo da doo dee doo da boo doo dee doo 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 dee doo dee da da. da, lee da, do da, dee da. What is that? A flat? Close enough for jazz. So, this pitch pipe and the visualization of this has been able, for me, has enabled me to get into music, to find out what's going on. Turn the radio on, boom, I know what they're playing. I know what keys are in. I'm taking educated guesses and checking. Sometimes I'm way off, sometimes I'm not. When you're not, you feel good. Was that a major scale? Was it a dominant southern scale? Take a guess. Take your pitch pipe and check it, you know? And that's what I did, and I think a lot of other people have done too over the last 30 or 40 years. The pitch pipe, I don't know what they used it for before, but jazzers use it to find out what the quality of chords. Is that major? Is it minor? Is it dominant seven? Does it have to match? What was that note they played right there, you know? What was that note they played over there against the chord? Was it the first note of the scale? Was it the second, third, fourth, fifth, sixth? Or was it maybe an altered note? So that pitch pipe and visualization of that keyboard has been one. That's my 5.5 years of college, to be perfectly honest. If you were to ask me, what did I get out of college, it would be the fact that Roger Pemberton, who lives in Columbus, South Carolina now, showed me and told me that you can develop your ear to the point where you can hear what's going on and you can become independent in that sense. And you don't have to have a sound go by and say, what was that? What was that? Or go for weeks and months and actually not know what it was at all. Okay? All right, let's take a look at something else. When I was young, I wish somebody had told me that. I wish they told me if you take a major scale and lower the sevenths, it becomes the all-important dominant sevenths. I didn't know that. I thought dominant seventh scales were something they played on the other side of the world, and I'd never be able to play them. Dorian minor scales, take a dominant seventh scale, keep the lowered seventh, lower the third, and it becomes your Dorian minor scale. Major, dominant, and minor, and then half diminished are your four qualities that are used most in Western music. We also use diminished scales and we use whole tone scales, and we use a lot of altered scales across this. They bring in flat nines, sharp fours, and sharp fives, all right? Which leads us to the point where we've almost got the chromatic scale going, and you can play any note across a dominant seventh that you want to and justify it by some way of a scale. So these are the big qualities here. And your pop music and your blues and so forth, and the jazzers have thrown in the blues scales. We also like major pentatonic scales. 1, 2, 3, 5, 6, 8, da, da, do, do, da. That sort of sounds oriental. And the minor, boo, oh, what is it? Boo, da, do, 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 dee, oh, do, 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 da, do, dee. And here's another one. Do, 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 dee, oh, do, 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 da. John Coltrane, I play these two a lot, right here, all right? So scales are extremely important, and let me show you something else here. Boy, I wish somebody told me this when I was about 16 years old. This is in your red book, okay? This chart here is in your red book. What it does is it says, if you know your major scales and are familiar with a major scale, a major scale, inside that scale are all the other scales you need to learn. Okay? So I'm gonna move over to the piano. C major. If you're, the ear tends to hear the high part and the bottom part first, okay? And ear training is trying to fill in, is it major? Is it minor? Are they playing a dominant seventh chord? And what's that strange note? Is that a sharp five or is it a sharp four? Or what is it, you know? But we usually hear the top and the bottom pretty quick, all right? So here's C major. So if the bass player plays C and G, that series of tones there, no sharps, no flats. I'm gonna start on the C. Now then, let's take the bass and move it from D to have it play the root and the fifth. Well, what we're thinking is, this is the D Dorian minor scale, which is related to the C major scale. They both have the same key signature, and they have the same fingering. Oh, all right, let's move up to E. E, and then play the fifth note of the E Phrygian scale. E and B, then you play across the scale with no sharps and no fuzz. I wish somebody had told me about when I was younger, because all through college and even out of college, I was still wrestling with this idea of 12 majors, 12 dominant sevens, 12 diminished. And it was like 48 scales, and I was just never going to get them together, you know? But no one ever knew, or no one took the time to tell me the relationship of like C major, D Dorian minor, G dominant seventh, and B half diminished, which I just played for you, are all the same fingering, Jamie. It's the bass note and the notes that you emphasize in your saxophone that emphasizes the quality of the sound. Another thing is a good place to start your phrases, and most people do it, is when they sing. Start a phrase on the first note of the scale, the third note of the scale, or the fifth note of the scale, and you can't go wrong. When you get to the end of your phrase, it could be long, or it could be short, end on the one, the three, or the five, that word you happen to be in the tune at that time. You can't go wrong. Now, a lot of times I think young, inexperienced jazzers think that when they take their solo, they have to play something that's never been played before. You know? We got to find those notes that no one has ever played against the chord. And that's, it's very frustrating. It really is, because it really can't be done. Everything has already been played. I can remember when I was, I think I was out of college, and I heard about Coleman Hawkins, saxophone player. He had a tune called Queer Notions. And I just happened to be messing around with the two whole tone scales, okay? And I thought I had some neat patterns on my saxophone that I discovered that were all mine, all right? And this older gentleman invited me over to his house to listen to records one night. And he puts on this record by Coleman Hawkins, playing Queer Notions. Now, this fella doesn't know anything about music, but I know it was destined for him to play it. Because the tune that Coleman Hawkins played happened to be based on the two whole tone scales. And when I heard him play this tune, it was kind of up-tempo. Melody, and then improvising on the whole tone scales. And here I thought I had just discovered something new. Of course, the record was probably 30 years old at that point. Then it dawned on me, Jamie, why don't you stop thinking about trying to play new stuff and just play what's in your head? Does that mean it's okay to end the phrase on the root, which the bass player is playing? And the piano player might even have the root in his voicing. I won't be new. It'll be new. Because nobody's ever thought to play it like you're going to play it. Plus the bass sounds down here, the piano sounds here, and you come in right here. It's okay. It's okay to play what you hear in your head. Now, let's take a look at this. So much to talk about. Incidentally, I guess you all probably got one of these. Did you get this little red flower? How many of you did not get it? I'm just curious. Did not. Okay, well, I hope there's some out there on the table. You take it with you if you're remotely interested in what we're talking about and becoming a better musician. That's our jazz camp we have up at the University of Louisville. First 2 weeks of July. I've been doing jazz camps since 1965. Next year will be my 50th year of jazz camps. Boy, that is fantastic. And I've liked every moment of it. Okay? But you ought to think about coming to our camp. All right? Are there any high school students in here? No, everybody college, okay. I really encourage high school students to come, especially if you're thinking about going to music school. If they're a junior in high school and they come to the camp, it changes a life. Because they see all these jazz greats, education, everybody's catering to their needs, they're playing in combos, they're doing master class, they're learning all this stuff we're talking about, but it goes on every day for 5 days, you know? At night, you get to hear three faculty groups play, there's jam sessions later on. So if they've thought about doing this with their life and going to this college and doing this, oftentimes it changes in that week's time because, boy, you just get 100% of jazz and improvisation and individuality and freedom on your instrument. And it's all directed toward you. It's not a big band where only a couple of people stand up and take a solo. On Friday, everybody takes a solo. Bass players, drummers, conga players, everybody takes a solo on Friday. Short solo is a summation of the week. But the camp has changed a lot of people's lives, even adults, okay? Let's take a look at this. This is from a book by Joe Raposo called The Whole Brain Approach, which I don't think is available anymore, but if you thought it was important and wanted to get it, you'd probably buy it on eBay. He talks about the left side of the brain being the analytical, technical, logical, analytical side, plays from knowledge, okay? I was never over here as a youngster, okay? I was always over here, the creative side. I just wanted to play. Wet the reed, put it on the mouthpiece, and let me go, you know? Did I know what I was doing? Heavens, no. I'm playing jazz. Why do you need to know what you're playing? I don't know what I'm playing. Why would anybody else want to know what I'm playing, you know? But once I got into teaching, age 20, 21, and then through my 20s and through my 30s, I gave a whole lot over here, a whole lot of thought. I had combos going up at my house every day instead of having private half-hour lessons or one-hour lessons. And little by little, I became a pretty good teacher because I could listen and see exactly what they needed to work on. Saxophone player would be playing, I'd say, oh, Do you realize you're tongueing about 90% of the time? If you listen to records, you don't hear anybody tongueing like that unless they're a rock and roll player, you know, or maybe a marching band. You're just tongueing too much. Oh, really? Yeah. Why don't you try to slur and play more legato? Let's try this again. Everybody can say, that's better. Oops, you just tongued 3 notes in a row. Haven't. Okay. Smooth that out. Have you ever taped yourself, recorded yourself? No. Start recording yourself. Listen to yourself back. And compare yourself to people on the records, you know? Compare yourself over and over and over. So I started using my left brain, and as I did, it started helping me as a player because I could think more about what I was going to do. And my solos began to make more and more sense. More and more sense. How many of you are going to come to the concert tonight? Good. You come and listen to what I'm talking about right now. I don't know what we're going to play tonight, and I've never played with these people before, okay? So it's going to be totally improvisational. We will pick tunes that we were all familiar with. The last thing I want to do, or anybody else wants to do, is to be put on the spot at a concert where you're actually playing a song you may have heard before, but you have never soloed on it. You don't know what the key is, you don't know what the chord progression is. It's like, don't let me solo on this one. You know, I'll pass. So we usually try to pick tunes that everybody knows, because there's no sense embarrassing somebody, all right? This is a short list of tunes, about 60 songs. These are tunes that are written primarily by a jazzers and probably don't have lyrics. These songs over here, most of them have lyrics. And the reason that myself and thousands of other people like to play this music called jazz is the melodies are challenging sometimes. Sometimes they're very simple, but they're beautiful melodies, okay? The harmony that goes underneath that the bass outlines and the guitar and the piano play chords to is a challenge. Some of them are simple, some of them are harder. Some of the tunes are slow, some are fast. Some are in 3/4, some are in 4/4. Some are bossa nova, some are not, et cetera, et cetera. Okay? So, and these songs over here, a lot of them have great lyrics. They tell a story. So you can't beat it. You got good lyrics telling the story with a nice melody over a fantastic harmony. You know? And so it's nothing like popular music in America and around the world over the last, what, 45 years, 50 years? The kid gets a guitar, and next thing you know, he's learning 3 chords. You know, there's a lot of jokes, and he's out making records. He's out playing dances and stuff. And little girls are asking for his autograph. Little does that guitar, and that's why at the end of that guitar's education, too. Once you get to the stage where somebody asks you for an autograph, look out. Because you feel like you've made it, especially nowadays. And if you get paid for that, that could be the end of the journey. But I know as an educator and a musician that within that person that's maybe just playing 10 tunes over and over every year or every night or whatever, I know that there's something much deeper inside of them. They just decided to stay where they're at. They're playing these simple chords over and over. They don't know. They know the other road's there, but they don't know what it is. And that's the road of jazz and music that came up through the last century and made it to about 1960 or so. And that's when Elvis Presley came out and the Beatles and this, that, and the other. And teenage music came along. There was no teenage music before a certain date. It was quality music played by big bands, singers, this, that, and the other, great solos, et cetera, et cetera. But along with teen music came a dollar sign. And in order to make music, we played this kind of music. And then a thing came along called payola. That's where people would pay the disc jockeys to play a tune, even though it may be inferior, but they would play it, and it would catch on. And enough people were doing that across the country that payola changed, I think, the whole structure of music and practicing and getting better and this, that, and the other, and digging inside and pulling out the real you. It stopped way back there with the 3 chords. Elvis Presley, the Beatles, and then hundreds of other groups and people that were thinking that way and doing that. Let me look here. Okay. When you hear somebody play, or when you play yourself, I suspect, how many of you like the sound that you get out of your instrument? This is usually pertaining to wind instruments. Okay, there's 3 people. How many of you don't particularly like your sound? Let's try that. Okay, that's about the same number. I don't know what that means. How many of you are wind players? Raise your hand up. Okay, now let's do the question again. How many of you like your sound? Okay, hands down. How many of you would like to improve your sound? Okay, it's a lot of people. And if you play trumpet, sax, trombone, if you're young, it takes a while to get to the point where you got the right mouthpiece and you got the concept of what you want to sound like in your head, all right? I haven't played tenor in about 10 years, but 2 weeks ago I got out my tenor mouthpieces. There must be 30 mouthpieces. So that's me over the years trying to find a tenor sound, trying this mouthpiece, trying this mouthpiece, trying this one, this one, and this one. So sound is very important, all right? And then the feel, your time feel. Do you play in time?
Do you practice in time?
When you're practicing your skills and your chords and your exercises and so forth, which I hope to get to in just a few minutes here, are you playing in time? It doesn't have a good feel. Or do you play ta 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 ta? If you're working on tonguing, that's good. But if you're playing jazz, you're not going to hear that type of articulation. Boo da 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 etc. Can you swing with a metronome? Practice your scales and your chords and so forth. It's nice to play in time with good articulation. Alright? And this connection with the mind and the instrument is probably the most important. You want to get a good sound, okay? But these three things together, they identify who you are. It's your musical personality. It really is. And I hear way too many saxophone players tumbling way too many notes. Same thing with trombones. Same thing with trombones. It's like they haven't learned how to slur things or to play them legato. But as soon as they start to sing, they don't go ta 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 ta. They go la 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 legato, okay? But they're not transferring that over to their instrument. Let me share a couple things here, which I wanted to do at the very beginning, and I just dove into it. All the answers to your questions concerning jazz can be found on recordings. Listen and find the answers. Those with ears will hear. And everybody can hear, but you need to work on your ear training, all right? How many of you knew that there was a Duke Ellington quarter, 25-cent piece? A couple of you? Yeah, it's out there. They're really hard to find. They had the 50 states quarters. When you got through with that, they did the Washington, D.C., and they had a contest. Duke Ellington was born in Washington, D.C. He won the contest. He had to be dead, of course. And he's on the quarter, 25-cent piece. They're very hard to find. All right? Did you know that there were, in the last century, that people that deal with words, they chose to represent the last 100 years, was jazz? I didn't know it until I read it. Yeah, that's really neat. I love that word jazz. Jazz means freedom. How many of you knew there was a postage stamp, jazz? Anybody? Nobody. Oh, you got them. All right. I bought them all up. I got several packs of them, you know. 2,000 in a pack, maybe? I got a couple that are unsealed. I'm leaving them for my grandson down the road, okay? Yeah, I got jazz stamps. I put them on just about everything except when I'm paying my taxes. And your voice lines note that your instrument can't. How many of you think that's true? Oh, it's true. I need a volunteer at this point. And if you do good, I'll give you a Duke Ellington quarter. I need a volunteer. Don't everybody rush the stage at once, please. I need one person to come up here. That means you're going to have to get out of your seat. Okay, now you don't want me to. Here we go. All right, good. Step right up.
Okay, I got the quarter ready. But only if you excel at this, what we're going to do, all right? Okay, here, I'll let you hold it. Yes, you got it. Now, if you do a good job, that can be yours. What do you think? Does this sound like fun? What instrument would you like?
Saxophone.
Oh, give me the quarter. Sing. All right, you just stand right here and listen to the keyboard, and I want you to sing. Keep that up to your mouth so I can hear you. Sing la 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 or something so I can see.
La 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 la.
One, two, don't pay attention to them, okay? Don't look out. One, two, three, four.
Bye.
question in order for you to keep the quarter. What key did we start out in? What key, well, I'll make it easier for you since it's closer to you. What key did we end in?
I think it was 8 flat.
Oh, no. You can't remember?
Yeah, I, if how you long? Play it again, I can tell you.
Okay. You get that, because that's right. Have you got perfect pitch? That's good. Don't spend that at McDonald's. Okay? You hang on to it, because you can't find it anymore. He did a good job, man. Yeah. And guess what? All of you can do that. All of you can do that. And each time a person would come up and sing, it's going to be different than the one before. Okay, I have done, it's been rare, but I've done like 2 or 3 at a time to come up and sing. And as they get going, the first person sings, not as long as he did, first person sings for a minute, then the next person sings, and they pick up a little bit of what this person ended with. You know, it's called dovetailing. That solo into the beginning of the next one. And then they go, by the time I get to hear, sometimes if it's a boy, they'll be laughing and scatting and kind of screaming, Scooby, Scooby, out here, they're really loosening up. But everybody matches the harmony. Nobody knows what key we're playing in, except if you got perfect pitch like that gentleman there, you know. But you can do it. The problem is, if you got the trumpet, the trombone, and the sax lined up to do that, I don't even think I'd want to hear it. I mean, because it would just take, by the time I hit a chord for 2 majors, and they find a note or 2 that works, they have no idea what the rest of the notes of the scale are. And I've already moved to another one. You know, so it's like chasing after the money truck or something. It's always like 20 feet ahead of you. If you can only get in there, you can get some gold bars, but you can never make it to there. It's just going too fast and it's too complex. Plus, you just haven't practiced enough on your instrument to get to the point where you can instantly do that. And if you work at it, you'll get to the point where you can do this. All right? Now, I'm going to play this on the piano. This is what this comes down to. I know some people are leaving. Was it something we played? I'm just joking with you, of course. You want to get to the stage. Here's where you want to reach, because your voice can already do it. It can't necessarily identify what it is, but it knows it sounds good. You hit a chord. You hit that top note, or maybe you want to play that top note. And you instantly know it's the sharp 4 of a major scale. Okay? Now, you don't know if it's E or A or B, unless you have perfect pitch, or unless you've worked on your ear training and got to the point where you've got what we call relative pitch. In other words, you can hear that. That's E major with a sharp 4, an A sharp up here on the top, and nothing else sounds like that. You move to any other key, the same voicing, but it's not gonna sound like E. So if you work at it, you get to the point where when you hear that, you just know it's E, okay? But get to the part where you can hear it. That's a major sound, and the note I hit is what note of the scale? Raise your hand if you think you know. This is called ear training. He knows. Anybody want to take an educated guess? It's a 6th note. That's what the 6th note of a major scale sounds like. All right? That's what the 4th note talking, you say, excuse me, you pick up the phone and you go, hello? And the other person says 4, and I say, yes, and you hang up. And they say, what was that? Or maybe you're using a speakerphone, and they can hear the other person say 4. And I say to them, oh, that's Wayne calling. It's Monday, we always play basketball at 4 o'clock, and that's Wayne just calling to check. He doesn't have to say, Jamie, this is Wayne King calling. Are we going to play ball again today over at the Boys and Girls Club at 4 o'clock? He just says 4. I say yes, hang up. Same thing. Sharp 9. 4th of minor. Can't be anything else. That's what it is. 3rd of half diminished. 5th of major. Sharp 5 of dominant. play what's on the screen. The top note stays the same. But the bottom, if you look at the bottom, it's going to come up. B flat, B, C, C sharp. So, and I'm going to change the quality each time. Not necessarily the quality, but the root's going to change, and its position in the scale is going to change. That's the root. Now I'll move to the second one there. All of a sudden, that note carrier is lying in bed sound asleep. So try it. Nothing happened, all right? All of a sudden, it's wide awake. It's the major seventh of a major chord. Country and Western music, it never plays on a minor key unless somebody steals your pickup truck or runs over the boss. So let's move the bass up to A flat. A flat dominant seventh, A flat major, A flat minor, and A flat half to minor, so if I can find it. Now you move to A in the bass. Thank you. Western Americanized music, people have used these different sounds, and the jazzer has gotten to the point where they hear those sounds in their head. Now, the older jazzers that haven't had jazz education, they may play a note, and if you walk up to them, for instance, say they play it. Jazz education came along where you started analyzing things, books came out and so forth, people were learning to play by themselves, listening to records and then looking at my books and other people's books and so forth, and using both sides of the brain and getting a more holistic approach to music, and sure enough, they can play Giant Steps sooner than the other generation because they know what goes into playing, or they can play certain tunes that I've always thought of as being really difficult tunes, but now they can play them sooner. Because they've got the knowledge on the left side of the brain, and they've been practicing like crazy, and the instrument cooperates. It's a natural evolution, so to speak. And I think our institutions of higher learning, like this one right here, and I don't know anything about your college, all right? I went to Indiana University. I spent 5.5 years there. When I got out, nobody wondered what I got my degree in, which was finally saxophone, incidentally. They finally gave up and let me actually play jazz on my senior recital and my graduate recital. And the hall was packed. It was the first time anybody had ever played jazz on a recital at Indiana University. So that broke things open. That would be about 1960, 1961, okay? But even today, that institution, which is one of the finest music institutions in the world, they don't prepare their music students. How many of you are music ed? Okay. They do not prepare, and I don't know if you all do or not, their students to be able to go out to a middle school or a high school and have a jazz band, let alone a combo where you're going to have improvisation, all right? And I know because of my school in Albany, Indiana, which is about 90 miles from IU. I live right down on the Ohio River, across the river from Louisville, Kentucky. That's where I grew up. I grew up one block from where I live, as a matter of fact. But in recent years, the last 3 years, the middle school, which is 1.5 blocks from my house, has had 2 new band directors from IU. And 1 new high school band director, which is another block down the street. None of those 3 people know anything about jazz. Nothing. I mean, nothing. So that means they spent 4 years in college, maybe 5 even, got no learning about how to operate a jazz combo with 9 kids or 15 kids or maybe 18 in some sort of a big band thing, you know? And that's not good. I blame the people at the top. You know, the dean of the School of Music, and probably the committee, this, that, and the other. And incidentally, 2 years ago when I first encountered this for the first time, I just couldn't believe that these people didn't know anything. And I was willing to go down and help them for nothing, of course, and I did, okay? And I got them going. But I wrote a full page letter to the dean. I said, look, this is not right. These people paid money, they've spent X amount of years in your place, and they get a job. But you have to prepare them for the job. And these jazz bands, which I didn't have when I was in school at all, of course, these jazz bands are meeting every day. And in one school, I guess it's a high school, they got a jazz band, they got a combo. So this guy's teaching jazz two classes out of every day and has no idea what's going on. Now, they're better at it now, and I've helped them and so forth, and I've gone down to have my group play for them, use the overhead projector. So those kids are learning something about what's going on, but they didn't learn that at college, and I think it's a disgrace. I think it's a disgrace. I think it needs to be taught everywhere. Not that everybody's going to be a jazzer, but I would hate to think that I'm going to spend, that I would spend my whole life, for instance, reading music and not being able to improvise. Let me read this to you. 1993, if you happen to write me, I'll probably keep the letter forever. Okay, 1993. Here, this is from a lady down in Georgia. Dear Mr. Amos or whoever gets this letter. Now, boy, am I glad I got hold of your catalog. I went to college on a full piano scholarship, majored in classical music, only to discover I'm basically a non-functional musician and one that's not having much fun. four-page letter, bottom of the second page. I resent the classical music establishment that brought me up. I resent their rigidity and narrow-mindedness, and especially their intolerance for creativity. I was always reprimanded and penalized when I was caught trying to play by ear and to do my own thing. I love the classics, but they're just a small piece of the big musical pie! Exclamation point. Learning notes is so rote and mechanical, such busy work, like filling in the spaces on a paint-by-number picture. I'd rather be the one who creates the picture itself. Creativity is where the fun is. Now listen to this. I believe I can learn in spite of my background. I believe you can teach yourself anything if you want it bad enough. Now what if her teachers knew that she was writing this letter after they spent all this money on her for a full scholarship, and she has the audacity to say, I believe I can learn in spite of my background. Oh, it's awful. Nobody should have to write a letter like that. And over at the end, I know several other classical musicians who are in the same boat I am. We're all trying to break those chains that bind us to the printed page, but we just don't quite know how. Have any of you been in that boat? Yep, there you are. A lot of people are on the boat. And it's sad, because at some point, life ends. Nobody gets out alive. And it's a shame to spend your whole life being chained to the printed page. So that's why I'm here today. And I'm not putting down in college at all. This is the way it is around me. I don't know how we're going to break it. I don't know. But I wrote the dean of the school at IU. I said, you need to have a semester for all music ed people where they play in a combo, where they are forced to take their instrument and learn to play some blues and maybe blue balsa and learn about chord. They don't have to memorize 100 tunes, but know how to tell students how to play the tune and to practice the different scales and chords and so forth. And it could be on blues. This is a more advanced tune right here. And then they know how to pick music for a combo, pick music for a big band. They need to talk about articulation. 2 weeks ago, I took my quartet over to Hazelwood Middle School, one 2 blocks from my home. We're going to play for the, that was 4 weeks ago. We're going to play for the jazz band, which has about 12 or 15 kids. But we got there early, and she's got the fifth graders. They're beginners, okay? I set up early and just went over to the saxophone player. He was having trouble fingering G. These are beginners. And I took my mouthpiece, put it on his horn, and I said, it works, it's fine. You're just not pressing hard enough. And then I looked at the clarinets. And I looked at the clarinets about 5 minutes. And I looked at it. I said, wait a minute, they got their hands backwards. They're like this. 5 or 6 clarinets, 3 of them have their hands backwards on their instruments. Do you think that's good? That's terrible. This young lady plays flute from Indiana University. This is her first school. She's already had band now for about 6 weeks. And I said something to her afterwards. I said, do you know you got 3 clarinet players fingering there? Yeah, she said, I tell them every day. And then, when we played for that fifth graders about 2 weeks later, I got on them. It was the day before they were going to take their 2-week break. Fall break. I said, now when I was here a couple weeks ago, I noticed some of you clarinet players with your hands backward. You don't want to do that. So you're wasting her time. If you're going to be in this class, music is a special thing. You all can be great musicians if you practice at it, but you can't be fingering the instrument incorrectly, so you got to pay attention to what's going on and help her out. And then I wrote her an email and said, what you need every year when you get the fifth graders come in, you need to hire, the school needs to hire a brass person to come in for that hour and work with the brass people, and a woodwind person to work with the clarinets and the saxes while you hold things together, da-da-da-da-da. And she wrote back and she said, next year I'm going to do that. I've been given permission to get somebody to come in and help me get these 20 or 25 people started off, you know. You never know where they're going to end up. You just never know. How many of you are used to thinking on numbers, like of a scale, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5? Anybody? Okay, that's quite a few of you. Have you ever thought in terms of simple tunes being digital, like Happy Birthday? Most people would probably think Happy Birthday starts on the root. It does. It starts on the fifth. Do do dee do 1 7. Do do dee do 2 1 5 5 up an octave. 5 3 1 and finally you outline the key you're in. 5 3 1 7 6 and then this is a note nobody can ever find on their instrument, although your voice knows where it is. 4 4 3 1 2 1 and then you might write it out. This is an experiment. Take a note G. And see if you can write Happy Birthday without staff paper and so forth. G G A G C B, G G A G D C, G G G E C B A, F F E C D C, and here's the numbers again, just like up here. If you start thinking numbers and get that in your head, it makes improvising and playing music a lot easier. It really does. Let me see what else I got. Oh, let me do another thing here. I know we're getting close to being out of time, but we don't have to play a concert until 7. Beats 1 and 3 are extremely important. When that boy was singing for us, a young man was singing for us, he was singing a lot of chord tones on beats 1, 2, 3, 4. 1, 2, 3, 1, 3, 5, 7. Even 9 sometimes, but basically 1, 3, 5. 1, 3, 5, 7. Let me show you where this comes from. It's the way most people sing. Everybody sings that way. But your instrument doesn't play that way because you haven't trained it to do so. You put a piece of music up, for instance, say you put, let's just use this tune up that I had up here just a minute ago. You step out of a dream, all right? So you take a look at the chart. 9 times out of 10, the intermediate, the novice player, if they were going to play on this, would play C as their first note, all right? If they were to sing, they might sing an E, or a G, or an A, or a B, okay? Because they're just hearing a sound and singing, and they know it fits. But with the instrument, you got your eyes going, and that's what you play. Now listen to this one.
me play something for you. I'm on saxophone, and you, I want you to raise your hand as soon as you think you know what I'm playing, okay? I'm not gonna embarrass you, so don't be afraid. As soon as you think you know what I'm playing, raise your hand. I'm not gonna play a melody. I'm gonna play an improvised solo, but I'm hoping that by emphasizing beats 1 and 3 with chord tones, that if you're used to listening to jazz, you know, you might be able to hear what I'm playing. It's not gonna be difficult. And I'm not gonna play fast tempo. 1 and 3 often enough that they actually know what you're playing. Now I'm going to give you a, I'm going to go back up to blues for a second. Practice. Take a look in your red book at page 17. 17. Hot Rod Queen. Do 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 do. Here's a good way to go about preparing yourself and your fingers to improvise on a song, okay? Since we're not, do we have any vocalists here? How many of you are vocalists? Okay, the vocalists need to practice their scales and chords and chord progressions of song just like the instrumentals. Because I can't imagine what it would be like to be a vocalist and you're gonna play a song but you have no idea what the first note you're gonna sing sounds like. You have to have the piano and the bass always strike first, and then you come. In other words, you can't anticipate because you have to use the left side of your brain to find where a B flat is, unless you have perfect pitch, of course.
All right, let's take this blues. I'm going to do an exercise. And I'm going to stop. And I want you to listen carefully. I'm not trying to trick you. I'm just doing simple exercises.
B flat blues.
1, 2, 1, 2, 3, 4. Who knows what exercise on that page 17 I just played? Who can take an educated guess? Nobody?
Four.
Number one?
Four.
Four. What is four? Let's see. Four. Yeah, four. I was playing triads. Right? Okay, back it up.
What's this?
One, two. 1, 2, 3, 4. Number two, I was playing the first five notes, and I was trying to make it swing as much as I could. What's this one?
One, two. I'm changing the rhythm.
1, 2, 3, 4. Was that five? Yeah, seven chords, right. So, by practicing your chords and your scale, and these simple things right here, okay, on that page 17. Down at the bottom of the page, it's got a practice procedure. It says, I strongly urge you to practice the above exercises using as a guide any of the following root sequences to assure yourself of practice in all keys. Number one is what? Chromatic scale ascending. What's number five? Chromatic scale descending. What's number two? Cycle of fourths, circle of fourths, circle, cycle, fourth, fifth. Okay? Number three, up to the slash mark is what? Whole tone scale. There's two whole tone scales. Number four is diminished chord, another diminished chord, another diminished chord to make sure you get through all 12 keys. And number six is a random. It goes up a minor third, C to E flat, then down a whole step. Up a minor third, down a whole step. All right, now I'm going to take number two right now. Through number two. I did C, then I did F, then I did B flat. What did I play? Raise your hand. Everybody heard it? Did you like it?
The saxophone.
I was playing triads. 1, 3, 5, 1, 8. Anybody know what I did? Everybody heard it. I played the first five notes of minor scales. I played the first five notes of the C minor scale, Then I played the first five notes of the F minor scale. Then the first five notes of the B flat. This is a good way to practice. Let's take number one. Which exercise at the top did I play through all 12 keys going up and a half scale? Everybody heard it. It was number five. I was playing seventh chords. Let's take the first five notes of the scale and you tell me, I'm going to do major, and you tell me at the bottom of the page which one of those six sequences am I using? Raise your hand if you know which one I was playing. All right, let's take you. Pardon me?
Five.
Number five? Number five?
Wait, you said
I was doing number five down here. Right. I was going down in half step. And which exercise did I play?
You played number five.
I played the first five notes of minor, wherever that is. That's number two right over here. Yeah. I went up and down. So this is a great way to practice, and I didn't know to do this when I was young. I thought it was important, but nobody told me to do it, so I didn't do it. Because when I got to the difficult keys, I just stopped, or I went and did something else. Have any of you ever done that before? Yeah, we all have. We all have, yeah. It's a common fault of all of us. But if you spend the time, like somebody see, have any of you heard of Herb Alpert? How many of you have heard of Herb Alpert? Raise your hand. All right, he's still putting records out with his wife, I think. But anyhow, he's a trumpet player. He was responsible for the Tijuana Brass. And he had a record company, which I don't think he has anymore, but he's probably new here many times over. Anyhow, when I was putting out Playboy records years ago, I would send him one. And he always sent me a thank you card. And I sent him volume 61, which incidentally I have some things for sale out there in the lobby. Anyhow, I sent him volume 61, which is called Burning. All the temples are very, very fast, okay? He sent me a card back and he said, volume 61, Burning, shines a spotlight on the weak links in the chain. I thought that was a great way to say, woo! And J.J. Johnson, when he got it, he wrote me a letter, the trombone player. He wrote me a letter and said, hey, Jamie, I'm getting ready for a trip to Japan and I'm practicing like crazy. And then he says, Burning, volume 61, which you just got in the mail. He went something like that, wrote that to him, like, wow, those tempos are fast. And incidentally, any of you have that play on record? It's really a challenge. And I remember each time when we did a track, I would talk to them while they were playing. I'd say, okay, we got one more chorus to go, 5 minute mark. I'm looking at my stopwatch and so forth. And Todd Kuhlman, the bass player on some of them, before we played each tune, he'd say, Jamie, how long is this one going to go? I'd say, Todd, it's going to go about 5 minutes. Okay? It's going to go about 5 minutes. Well, anyhow, I had my metronome there, and I'd say, okay, this is whatever the tune is, Cherokee, quarter note equals 300, all right? Next one is quarter note equals 305 or whatever. Got through with the whole project, and I made a cassette, I guess, or maybe a CD, I can't remember, and sent it to Jerry Coker down in Knoxville to practice with. And I hadn't put the booklet yet together. We were working on the tunes, the copyist was copying the tunes and stuff, and Jerry wrote me a long letter. Said, Jamie, I think your metronome markings are off on this new 561 Playboy. I went, what? Because Jerry is so exact, so whatever he says is going to be right. Well, I got my metronome now, and I put the CD or the cassette on, whatever I had then as a preliminary to breaking the CDs. And the first one is wrong. Jerry's right, huh? I'll try the next track. Hey, it's wrong too. And all of them, what I told the guys, like quarter note equals 300, it was actually like 320. If I told him 320, it was like 350. So they were playing much faster than they thought they would play. I took that metronome, one of the little black ones, you know, with the light on the top, and I threw it in the trash. But I should have kept it, because it enabled those guys to play fast for a long time, thinking they were playing at a slower tempo. I thought that was kind of neat. Okay, so anyhow, just back to this. This is a basic page here. And the other pages in this red book are all extremely important. And if you have any questions along the way, don't hesitate to email me. Jamie@jazzbooks.com. Okay, and I answer all the questions. And don't be embarrassed asking me a question because I think I've heard everything. And I've got an answer for just about everything. Anybody have any questions? I appreciate you all sticking around. I enjoy doing this, as you can tell. And if you want to continue with this, you need to come up to our camp for a week. We usually have about 50 to 55 faculty, about 15 staff. We usually have somewhere between 250 people each week. And we used to have 400. Times have really changed. Can you imagine that? 400 people, all ages, studying this music. It's great. And it's music from about 7, well, you start class at 8:30, and we have about 5 theory classes. Yeah, we have 5 theory classes. And then we have various combos. We have a short audition on Sunday, and then you take a short theory test. We place you in the theory class. If you're in the wrong class after the first day, move to another class. If you're in the wrong combo, the combo is too advanced for you, or they're below you, come see us. We'll move you to another combo. We try to be as accommodating as possible. We have just about every instrument. I think we got just about all instruments, okay? And that's it. We have a week, a great week. And then on Friday, each combo plays. They have a 10-minute selection. Everybody solos. Everybody goes home and enthused, okay? So if you want to continue on, y'all think about that, because July will be here before you know it. Any questions? About anything? Transportation? Marriage? Mortgages? Price of gas? Your price of gas is cheap, incidentally. Where I live, in Louisville, Kentucky, it's always high. You go 50 miles in any direction, and it drops down 20, 30 cents a gallon. I don't know why it's so high where we live. Okay, I think we'll wrap it up. If you got anything you want to talk to me about, please come down and talk while I'm packing my stuff up. Then we'll have a concert here starting at 7 o'clock tonight. Thank you very much. Thank you, guys, for having me.
You're amazing. Thank you so much.